হ্যাঁ তোমরা দেখতে পাচ্ছ এখন শুনতে পাচ্ছ ও ও আচ্ছা আচ্ছা মিউট করা আছে দেখো তো এটা সাউন্ড অন ইউ হিয়ার মি
ইয়েস ম্যাম
ও
ইয়েস ম্যাম
ওকে ওকে সো লেটস স্টার্ট টুডে প্রিভিয়াস
ইয়ার স্টিল নট অডিবল ম্যাম
নট অডিবল
নো ম্যাম ইউ আর অডিবল
হ্যালো ডু ইউ হিয়ার মি
ম্যাম ইউ স্টিল মিউটেড
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, still muted. Let's go, Bianca. Bianca muted. Bianca?
Teams e giye unmute korte hobe.
Kotha giye? Ha, repeat. Bianca, repeat it. Oh, shunte pachhi na. Bianca ke jonno mute kora ache. Eta ekta ki bollo? লুবিয়াঙ্কা বলো তোমার তুমি তুমি মিউট আছো অনলি ওরা শুনতে পাচ্ছে দেখো হ্যালো হ্যালো Do you hear me? Do you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
Oh, so I should start now. Today, previous class, I discussed about the varicose vein, and now I today's topic is. Today's topic is deep venous thrombosis or the DVT. This is our another more important topic in our surgical domain, and we day to day in our day to day practice we face this problem. So, what is DVT or the deep venous thrombosis? Deep venous thrombosis is that is a normally blood remain in the fluid state in our body. There is a clear balance between the procoagulant and anticoagulant. If any one of them is takes upper hand. If the procoagulant take upper hand, there is thrombus formation within the venous lumen. And if there is anticoagulant, if anticoagulant take upper hand, then there is the increased bleeding tendency from different part of our body. So first of all, what is thrombus? Thrombus is nothing but a semi-solid coagulum within the venous system. It is a major cause of mortality and morbidity in our hospitalized patient. And in DVT, most commonly affect the lower limb. Upper limb is rarely affected. The most dreaded sequelae of acute DVT is the pulmonary embolism. Now, causes of the thrombus formation. There is a triad known as the Virchow's triad. The component of the Virchow's triad is stasis of blood, hypercoagulable state in the blood, and the vessels injury. And these three collectively responsible for the development of thrombus within our venous lumen. So as a result of stasis, there is endothelial cellular layer contact with the activated platelet and procoagulant that leads to thrombus formation. Tissue injury. Again, there is release of tissue factor or the procoagulant from the procoagulant and this which initiate the thrombus formation. Next is the physiological, another condition known as a physiological stress or the that may occur following the surgery, that may be general surgery or orthopedic surgery. Increases platelet count, adhesiveness, and changes in the coagulation cascade and changes in the fibrinolytic system and increased risk of thrombosis. There is another important condition known as hypercoagulable state. This hypercoagulable state associates increased high chance of thrombus formation within the venous lumen. So what are these hypercoagulable state in our body? That these are the factor 5 bleeding mutation, prothrombin gene mutation, and natural anticoagulant deficiency, that may be protein C, protein S, or the protein 3 deficiency. Homocysteinemia, antiphospholipid syndrome, lupus antibody, and anticardiolipin antibody. These are the common hypercoagulable state in our body. What are the predisposing factors for development of the thrombosis? This is a malignant disease. The malignant disease, most commonly it is associated with, it produces the hypercoagulable state in our body that lead to thrombus formation. Increased BMI. BMI is more than body mass index. It is more than, if it is more than 30, and increasing age. If the age of the people is more than 60, these two groups of people are less mobile. So there is stasis of the blood within the venous system, within the extremity, that may lead to thrombus formation. Another important condition is the pregnancy. During the pregnancy, the gravid uterus obstructing the common iliac vessel. And this, so there is common iliac vessel as well as there is the high level of estrogen and progesterone level that may decrease the venous tone. And both these conditions act synergistically and produce the stasis of the blood in the periphery and they produce the thrombosis. Another important factor is the prolonged immobilization that may occur as a result of long journey by bus or by pain or the after surgery like hip replacement, knee replacement that lead to prolonged immobilization and there is stasis of the blood that subsequently lead to thrombus formation. Smoking is another important factor that may induce the thrombosis. The more smoking damages the lining epithelium of the blood vessels and it may trigger in the thrombus formation. And history of prior DVT, another important factor for thrombus formation. And there is a high dose of estrogen therapy again that is responsible on the thrombus formation. Here you see the picture of prolonged immobilization in a flight, long journey. There is the stasis of the blood in the peripheral extremity and that may aggravate the condition again. So there are, I told you, there is a natural anticoagulant deficiency. What is the hypercoagulable state? When there is the natural anticoagulant deficiency, natural anticoagulant deficiency associated with the increased risk of thrombus formation. This naturally occurring anticoagulants are, that is the antithrombin 3, protein C, and protein S. All are naturally occurring anticoagulants. How they will act? normally amphithrombin 3 acts after binding to heparin sulfate on the endothelial surface and inhibit the activity of the thrombin factor 9, factor 10 and factor 12, 11. 14C is another naturally occurring anticoagulant where it is activated when the thrombin binds to the thrombomodulin and inhibit the factor 5 and 8. Another factor is the protein S. This protein S inhibits the prothrombin conversion to thrombin and activation of the factor 8. So in this naturally anticoagulant deficiency, this disorder usually passed as in an autosomal dominant manner, and there may be type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is quantitative as well as qualitative deficiency of this naturally occurring anticoagulant and type 2 associated with only qualitative deficiency of this factor. And more in our country, like in India, we most commonly see the protein C deficiency. Next is the factor 5 ledin. What is factor 5 ledin? That is the factor 5 normally, the factor 5 after mutation, a single point mutation, it is converted into factor 5 ledin gene. And this is an autosomal dominant disorder. And normally factor 5 in our body is degraded by activated protein C. But when the factor 5 converted into factor 5 ledin, it is not degraded in our body. Because why it is not degraded in our body? Because there is an arginine at the level of 506 position in the polypeptide chain is replaced by glutamine in the factor 5, which makes it resistant to degradation by activated protein C. Another hypercoagulable state, that is the homocysteinemia. This disorder can be either inherited or acquired. Increase in homocysteine level, that is more than 22 micromole per liter, is associated with increased risk of venous thrombosis. Women seem to be more risk of developing DVT than men. Vitamin supplementation does not reduce the risk of recurrence. Another important hypercoagulable state like antiphospholipid syndrome. If there is associated antiphospholipid syndrome or APS, it is associated with recurrent pregnancy loss. And this may be primary or the secondary. Primary APS does not associate it with any other autoimmune disorder, but secondary APS associated with autoimmune disorder like SLE. SLE is the most commonly associated condition with secondary APS. APS significantly increases the risk of thrombosis both in the first and as well as recurrent. The criteria for diagnosis of the APS. APS may be clinically you can diagnose or laboratory. There are some laboratory criteria. What are those criteria? Clinical criteria, one or more episode of arterial, venous or small vessel thrombosis in any tissue or organ, and one or more unexplained death of a morphologically normal fetus at or beyond 10th week of gestation, and one or more premature birth of a new morphologically normal neonate before 34 week of gestation due to severe eclampsia, preeclampsia or features of placental insufficiency. And laboratory criteria are the presence of lupus anticoagulant in the plasma on two or more occasions, at least 2 weeks apart. And anticardiolipin antibody, the IgG or IgM, present in the serum or plasma in two or more occasions, at least 12 weeks apart, which is measured by the ELISA test. And another criteria is the anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibody of the IgG or IgM in the serum or plasma on two or more occasions, at least 12 weeks apart. These are the laboratory criteria for the diagnosis of APS or antiphospholipid syndrome. Now the pathology of the thrombus formation, how the thrombus usually form in our body. If there is any one of the component of the Virchow triad is activated, then there is the aggregation of the platelet within the venous wall. Once there is when the deposition of platelet within the venous wall, there is the clotting cascade of the thrombosis started, and the deposition of the fibrin over the activated platelet and over the fibrin, the red blood cell deposited over the fibrin and aggregated platelet and forms a mass, and then subsequently that lead to the lead to occlusion of the lumen of the vein, and that occlusion of the lumen of the vein and produce the thrombosis. And this thrombosis, once it is formed, it progresses proximally, and it progresses proximally towards the inferior vena cava and involving the large major veins. And so this sometimes the part of the thrombus may dislodge and may enter in through the heart. It may enter into the lungs and produces pulmonary embolism. Here you see the picture. That is the process of how the thrombus is formed. This is the initially starting, the platelets are still deposited in the venous wall, and subsequently there is the fibrin plaque. The clotting system is activated and the fibrin plaque is deposited over the venous wall and to produce a large thrombus which may propagate proximally towards the larger vein, and then sometimes the part of the thrombus may dislodge and it's known as the emboli, and this embolism may enter into the lungs and produces pulmonary embolism. Now the clinical diagnosis. Clinical features, mostly unilateral, and 40% have clinical manifestation like the pain, low-grade pyrexia, and tenderness. Another important sign is Hohmann sign. Hohmann sign is the pain in the calf on dorsiflexion of the foot, but the absence of Hohmann sign does not rule out DVT. Now, another important term known as phlegmatia alba dolens. What is phlegmatia alba dolens? That is the when the thrombus involving the major vessel like the iliofemoral vein, this produce the condition. Then the patient present with massively swollen leg with pitting edema and pain. This condition known as the phlegmatia alba dolens. And when the phlegmatia alba dolens, there's a leg become massively swollen, and then it may subsequently, if untreated for a long time, it may subsequently occlude the arterial flow and produces the painful blue leg, or known as the venous gangrene. If it is this condition is not treated immediately, then it may lead to the amputation of the leg may be required. Here you see the picture of phlegmatia alba dolens. Phlegmatia cerulea dolens, that the blue leg, or the it is the condition on the venous gangrene. Now PTS, post thrombotic syndrome. It occurs 20 to 50% patient. It present with the chronic edema, pain, venous claudication. Venous claudication means there is if the long standing thrombus within the deep venous system. There is the stasis of the blood within the periphery, and this stasis subsequently lead to the peripheral hypertension, and this as a result of peripheral hypertension there is the ulcer within the venous ulcer in the greater area of the leg. This is I already described it in previous class. So this is the another important complication of post thrombotic symptom. What are the predisposing factors for this stroke? That is the persistent leg symptoms, like these persistent leg symptoms after acute DVT, anatomically extensive DVT, recurrent ipsilateral DVT, prolonged subtherapeutic anticoagulation. Treatment mainly supportive. Now, after clinical confirmation, now a laboratory investigation or the radiological investigation is required to confirm our diagnosis. There is few laboratory tests and there are few radiological investigations are there. The most important laboratory test is the D-dimer assay. Another radiological investigation, that is the compression USG, Doppler USG, venography. Venography may be CT venography or MR venography. D-dimer is during the fibrinolysis, plasmin knocked on the fibrin polymer to produce the D-dimer, which is specific marker for activation of intravascular coagulation. The D-dimer are normally, sometimes in few people, D-dimer are detectable in normal healthy individual, but sometimes it may be elevated in a few other conditions like old elderly people, pregnancy, other systemic disorder and malignancy. And the derma returned to the normal level after 2 weeks of post-thrombosis. There are a few methods for measuring the estimating the D-dimer value. There may be agglutination method or ELISA method. Agglutination method is usually it will take ELISA method. It will take more time but easy to perform. But it is most sensitive and but takes a longer time. While the agglutination method is less sensitive and rapid to perform. The normal D-dimer value less than 5 mg/L. What is plethysmography? It is used to measure the changes in the volume of the tissue due to variation in the blood flow or the tissue fluid in the different part of the body. This may be done to check the blood clot in the arm and the leg. This can be measured by photoplethysmography, stain gauge plethysmography, impedance plethysmography, and it is convenient and easy test that can be performed at the bedside. The most important type of plethysmography, the impedance plethysmography. Here, the measure the changes in the venous capacitance and rate of emptying of the venous volume on temporary occlusion and release of occlusion. If you inflate the calf in the upper thigh and followed by you deflate the calf in the upper thigh. Normally, there is rapid outflow and reduction of the volume. But in presence of thrombosis, there is the prolongation of the outflow. There is one drawback, that is that it is not useful clinically for detection of the calf vein thrombosis and in patient with the prior history of DVT. This is the investigation of choice. This is the duplex ultrasound. It is the color Doppler ultrasound plus color flow imaging. The advantage of this duplex ultrasound, it is non-invasive, it is the comprehensive, patient compliance, low cost and readily available, better patient well-being and no contrast is advantage, no contrast is required. Disadvantage, that is the decreased visualization of the vein in the lower part of the pelvis. During duplex USG, following distal compression, you can see there is augmentation of the flow, and proximal compression, there is interrupted flow. This happens naturally, normally, but in presence of thrombosis, if you compress the vein distally, there is no augmentation of the blood flow. As well as normal vein is compressible, but thrombus vein resistant to compression. At the chronicity of the thrombus, you can diagnose as well as the chronicity of the thrombus, which can be evaluated depending on the echogenicity and heterogeneity. Here you see the another important sign, that is the Mickey Mouse sign. This Mickey Mouse sign represent the normal venous anatomy. Common femoral artery, common femoral vein, and great saphenous vein. You can see it normally. If you place the probe below the inguinal ligament, but if it is this sign is absent, that means there may be thrombus within the common femoral vein. The next one is the venography. Venography is the invasive method. Venography invasive method. That is the investigation of gold standard investigation. The superficial venous system is occluded with the tourniquet and contrast material injected into the vein of the foot, and then you visualize the deep venous system. If there is any filling defect, you can that means there is the venous thrombosis. Only disadvantage is there is the risk of allergy to the contrast medium. Here you see the venography. This portion of the common iliac vein is absent. That means there is a thrombus within the deep venous system. That he has this portion of the vein is not seen, this because there is a thrombus formation. It's a picture of the venography. And MR venography for diagnosis the proximal venous disease and helps direct visualization of the thrombus. It is non-invasive test. There is one criteria, is there, Wells criteria. It is not usually performed on the regular basis. Prophylaxis. Prophylaxis, patient who has undergone major abdominal surgery, major orthopedic surgery, major trauma, and prolonged immobility, more than 3 days. Then you advise the prophylactic therapy. Mechanical prophylaxis. Following the major surgery, you advise the patient to mobile, as if possible, work as early as possible, to activate the peripheral muscle pump. But if the mobilization is not possible, in that situation, you can advise the patient, you can prescribe the sequential compression device and or the that prevent the venous stasis. Here you see the pneumatic compression, intermittent pneumatic compression device to prevent the venous stasis in the peripheral extremity. Okay. So pharmacological prophylaxis is when we can use low dose unfractionated heparin, low molecular weight heparin, fondaparinux, and rivaroxaban. And these above three preparation are injectable, and fourth one is orally available. Unfractionated heparin prophylaxis. Prophylaxis dose is 5,000 units subcutaneously. 8 hourly or 12 hourly. But treatment of acute DVT, that is the 80 unit per kg IV bolus, and then continuous infusion of 18 unit per kg per hour, or 5,000 unit IV bolus, then continuous infusion of 1,300 unit per hour. It is the treatment of the acute DVT, and then it is maybe prescribed after 5 to 10 days, and followed by warfarin therapy for another 3 months. In case of low molecular weight heparin, prophylactic dose is the in case of abdominal surgery, 40 milligrams subcutaneously once daily, should be initiated 2 hours preoperatively, and continue treatment for 7 to 10 days. In orthopedic surgery, 40 milligrams subcutaneously, initiate 9 to 15 hours postoperatively, continue for 10 days, or it may extend up to 35 days. It is the prophylactic dose, but in presence of thrombosis, acute thrombosis, the treatment is dose of the low molecular weight heparin, 1 milligram per kg subcutaneously, 12 hourly, or 1.5 milligram per kg subcutaneously once daily. Continue low molecular heparin for a minimum period of 5 days until the INR is 2 to 3. Average duration of the treatment is 7 to 10 days. But is this after initiation with the low molecular heparin, you initiate, after that you continue the warfarin for another 3 months. Next is fondaparinux. Fondaparinux prophylactic dose, more than, if the body weight of the patient more than 50 kg, 2.5 milligrams subcutaneously once daily for 5 to 9 days or up to 10 days. Following abdominal surgery and in orthopedic surgery, it is 10 to 14 days it is recommended. Treatment is in presence of acute DVT. In presence of acute DVT, dose of fondaparinux, if the patient weight less than 50 kg, advise 5 milligrams subcutaneously once daily, or if the body weight 50 to 100 kg, then advise the dose 7.5 milligrams subcutaneously once daily. If weight more than 100 kg, 10 milligrams subcutaneously once daily, and continue for 5 to 9 days, and then continue the treatment with warfarin. Then rivaroxaban. The prophylactic dose rifaroxaban, that is a 10 milligram per orally once daily for 12 days in knee replacement, and 10 milligram per orally once daily for 35 days in hip replacement. But treatment in case of acute thrombosis is 15 milligram per orally 12 hourly for 21 days, then 20 milligram per orally once daily for rest of the period. Prevention of the postoperative DVT. Prevention of the postoperative DVT, you may start anticoagulant as early as possible, and compression use advice to use compression stockings, and do advice to do regular exercise and early ambulation. And if early ambulation not possible, then sequential compression device or intermittent pneumatic compression is advised. So this is the prophylactic measure to prevent the postoperative DVT. The treatment phase of treatment of acute DVT. I already told you the doses of drug in case of acute DVT. There is a three treatment phase. Phase one, initial treatment phase up to 10 days with the aim of treatment to prevent the propagation of the DVT and pulmonary embolism. Phase one, it is the principal treatment phase. The first 3 months. To maintain the therapeutic level of anticoagulation to prevent the propagation of the DVT and pulmonary embolism and reduce the risk of early recurrence of venous thromboembolism. Phase 3, this is the extended treatment phase. The extended treatment phase, after the principal treatment period of 3 months, the recurrence risk varies depending on the underlying risk factor. And sometimes patient may need lifelong anticoagulation if there is any congenital disorder, like antithrombin, hypercoagulable state like natural anticoagulant deficiency, antiphospholipid syndrome or homocysteinemia, hyperhomocysteinemia, etc. Thrombolysis. The aim of the thrombolysis in patient advantage, why the thrombolysis is required? Thrombolysis is required the relief of the sick, relief of the patient, and restore the blood flow within the venous lumen, and to reduce the symptoms like pain, fever, swelling, etc., and to prevent the long-term complication. And one disadvantage of this thrombolysis, there is the increased risk of bleeding. Treatment, I already told you, the heparin treatment or unfractionated heparin treatment is to maintain the APTT during the course of therapy with unfractionated heparin. The APTT level should be raised, normal APTT level 30 to 40 seconds, and it may be raised, it is raised up to 60 to 70 seconds. I previously already told you that is the bolus dose of heparin, that is the 80 unit per kg or 5000 unit IV, followed by 18 unit per kg per hour or 1300 unit per kg per hour continuous infusion, followed by warfarin to maintain the INR 2.5 to 3. And we should start within the 72 hours after initiation of parenteral anticoagulation. Sometimes if associated with known hypercoagulable state or history of prior DVT, you may continue the anticoagulant lifelong. You may continue anticoagulation for lifetime. And accepted INR ratio 2:3. Now, during the pregnancy with venous thrombosis, drug of choice is low molecular weight heparin. Now, with how the anticoagulation act. And first of all, discuss with unfractionated heparin. Unfractionated heparin, it inhibits the both factor 2 and factor 10, as well as low molecular weight heparin, again, it inhibits the factor 10 and the factor 2. And the parenteral anticoagulation should be given at least 5 days and therapeutic INR maintained above 2. And use of unfractionated heparin, it is used especially in case of the patient present with renal insufficiency, and if the patient on hemodialysis or in critically ill patient. A lower APTT ratio should be raised within the 24 hours starting of the treatment. a lowered APTT in the first 24 hours associated with a higher incidence of recurrence. I already told you the normal value of APTT 30 to 40 seconds, but in with the treatment with unfractionated heparin, the value is 60 to 70 seconds. Monitoring of anti-factor 10A activity target value which is 0.3 to 0.7 international unit per minute that can produce the more reliable result than APTT monitoring. Now, come to the low molecular weight heparin. It is given subcutaneously with the dose adjusted according to the body weight of the patient. I already told you 1 milligram per kg per 1 milligram per kg in 12 hourly dose. And low molecular weight heparin may be administered once or twice daily. And target peak value of anti-factor 10A, that is 0.6 to 1 international unit per minute for twice daily administration, and 1 to 2 international per minute for once daily administration. And a target APTT is for 60 to 70 seconds, but normal value is 30 to 40 seconds. Fondaparinux, it is another anticoagulant. It is given subcutaneously. Starting dose is 7.5 milligram. If the patient weight is less than 50 kg, receive 5 milligram. And dose weight more than 200 kg, receive 10 milligram. Because of its low molecular weight, it accumulates in the kidney. So in presence of with renal insufficiency, it should not be prescribed. Or if the creatinine clearance is less than 30 ml per minute, we should not advise that this drug. It is a synthetic anticoagulant. It is a direct inhibitor of the indirect inhibitor of the factor 10A, and it is antithrombin. It is an important antithrombin binding factor. It does not inhibit the thrombin at all. It anticoagulant that makes up the minimal antithrombin binding region of the heparin, but does not inhibit the thrombin. But it inhibit the it is indirectly inhibit the factor 10A. Another drug is known as dabigatran. Dabigatran, it is administered. It is most important thrombin inhibitor. It is administered at the dose of 150 milligram BD, which should be started after at least 5 days of initial parenteral anticoagulation. And it is oral drug, and it is primarily excreted in the kidney, so it is contraindicated in patient with creatinine clearance less than 30 ml per minute. And during with the treatment with the dabigatran, renal function should be monitored. It is potent synthetic non-peptide thrombin inhibitor. This inhibition of the thrombin results in the decreased formation of the fibrin and reduces the thrombin-stimulated platelet aggregation, thus prevent the formation of the thrombi. Rivaroxaban is new in another newer oral drug. Without any parenteral anticoagulation, it may start and initial initially. From the beginning, the first day of treatment, it will start with the initial starting dose should be high 50 milligram BD twice daily for 3 weeks, followed by standard dose 20 milligram orally once daily for rest of the period. It inhibits both the free factor 10 and factor free factor 10A and factor 10A bound in the prothrombinase complex. It is highly selective direct factor 10A inhibitor with rapid onset of action. So the parenteral anticoagulation is not required. Unlike the warfarin is a delayed onset of action, so it is not prescribed initially. And it is safer than warfarin. Chances of bleeding, cerebral and GI bleeding is less than warfarin. Management of the bleeding. Warfarin is the drug most commonly associated with upper GI bleeding in most cases. Vitamin K is the specific and direct antidote of vitamin K antagonist. In case of severe bleeding, immediately start vitamin K antagonist, and clotting factor should be administered, that the prothrombin complex concentrate containing factor 2, factor 9, factor 10, and also contain factor 8. FFP was found inferior to the prothrombin complex concentrate. In spite of all this anticoagulation, if there is venous patency is not restored, then you advise the patient that the endovascular reconstruction is required. Like conduct chronic venous occlusion with iliofemoral vein, then decanalization of the occluded vein endovascularly with balloon dilatation of the lesion or the stenting. If the anticoagulant treatment with anticoagulation is failed. DD of differential diagnosis of DVT is the ruptured Baker cyst, calf muscle hematoma, ruptured plantaris muscle, thrombopopliteal aneurysm, and arterial ischemia. Upper extremity deep venous thrombosis. I already told you at the starting that upper extremity deep venous thrombosis is rare. It approximately affects the 5% of the people and most commonly causes the pulmonary embolism. Thrombosis of the axillary and subclavian vein is common. The causes may be idiopathic or secondary. Idiopathic most commonly cause idiopathic. Secondary may be due to the indwelling catheter, central venous catheter, pacemaker, thrombophilia, or the hypercoagulable state like malignancy. Symptoms similar like the lower extremity, unilateral swelling of the leg, swelling of the arm, pain in the arm, extremity discomfort, erythema, and palpable cord-like structure. Diagnosis by, again, it is the duplex ultrasonography. It is the combination of B-mode ultrasonography with the color Doppler. Treatment with anticoagulation like lower extremity deep venous thrombosis. And complication, again, the same, that is the high chance of recurrence and post-thrombotic syndrome. Now the vena cava filter. Vena cava filter is usually used to protection of the inferior vena cava from the pulmonary embolism. The indication of vena cava filter, that is a recurrent thromboembolism despite adequate anticoagulation. Or deep venous thrombosis with contraindication to anticoagulation therapy, or chronic pulmonary embolism with resultant pulmonary hypertension, and the complication of the anticoagulation that may stoppage of the duct. That in that situation, vena cava filter may be used. Propagating iliofemoral venous thrombosis with anticoagulation, where we may use the vena cava filter. Complications of vena cava filter. That is the wound hematoma, migration of the device into the pulmonary artery, and trapping of the embolus in the filter and the caval vena cava obstruction. So these are the complications that may use that may happen following the use of the vena cava, following use of vena cava filter to prevent the pulmonary embolism. That's all about the deep venous thrombosis. So you tell me about your queries. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you any queries? You tell me. Do you understand what I have told?
Yes, ma'am.
No queries. So. So that's all about deep venous thrombosis. So thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. আমি সেই জন্য সবগুলোর যে ছবিটা চেষ্টা করেছি যাতে যেগুলো ঠিক কথা একদম
দেখো
ভাবো
১৩০০